Everybody's got to believe in something. Everybody's got to believe in something. Everybody's got to believe in something. Break it down.
GSL 10주년이라 드디어 올 것이 왔군. 좋아, 이제 한번 제대로 시작해볼까? 2020 GSL 시즌 1 코데스 쇼다운. 자, 한판 붙어보자고. 아프리카 TV 브레이크업 스튜디오 라이브 2020 GSL 시즌 코데스 쇼다운.
What's up, everybody? We're here at the last day of this phase of the GSL Codex. We are, of course, starting a little bit early today because we do have the group selection right after the tournament ends.
Yeah, and that's going to be a lot of fun to see what those groups are going to end up looking like. Of course, the group we have here today, a very exciting one. Special going to be playing Stats Hurricane and Taeja coming back as well.
Very exciting to have Taeja back here. I really want to see how he's performed. If you followed Starcraft 2, from Legacy of the Void on, you might not be as familiar with Taeja, but Taeja was a really dominant force, especially in tournaments outside of Korea in the early days of StarCraft II, the Wings of Liberty era. A very, very impactful player from that time period. So I look forward to seeing how he plays. Of course, other players like Stats, much more present here in Legacy of the Void. We've got a good mix of players.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's going to be a very fun group, I think that for sure. Here's who we have already advancing. It's a really great racial distribution thus far.
Yeah.
And we'll see if we keep that alive. Of course, we did have a couple of really big upsets. Rogue and SOS, for instance, falling out.
Yeah, SOS looking very, very, very impressive with his games, but did not win enough of them to allow him to advance. But that Nexus Rush game will go down in history.
Yeah, that was a crazy one, no doubt.
That was insane.
We've had some, we've had quite good groups here. Some of them had some one-sided games for sure because it's the round of 24. But like for instance, if you are just tuning in because you're a special fan, you're like, oh, I have enough time to catch up on one group, Artosis. What is that group? Because I know so many people are in that boat. The Ragnarok Parting group, I think, was really good.
Yeah, that was a great group.
That was the best one, I think.
But you know, usually this phase of the tournament does have the most one-sided games. That can be good for learning sometimes if you want to just see how to do one build straight up and beat another player, but it tends to get closer and closer, especially when we get to the round of eight. Anyways, today, Hurricane or Hurricane versus Taeja Special and Stats.
Hurricane. I like Hurricane.
Yeah.
That's kind of cooler.
Doctors say don't take Hurricane with alcohol. Side effects might be drowsiness, sleepiness.
I haven't seen Juan yet at all.
So we don't know what's going on yet. He's not the first match. But as you can see, he's not there right now. And so,
I'm sure he must be on his way. I was texting with him this morning, so.
I'm sure he's
I know he knows he plays today.
Yeah. I also know the traffic's not that bad right now in Seoul.
He lives kind of far away. But.
So hopefully he gets here in time. I think we've had this happen maybe once or twice before. I think once in an ASL and once in a GSL where a player was late. And they were late enough we had to just not have the match.
Huh. Well, he's probably here.
I'm sure he'll get here. If he's not there, he's probably going to just make up done. Anyways, more importantly, we're going to go to our first match.
Yeah. So Hurricane actually comes in as the top seed in the group. He's had some good results as of late, so that could surprise you. I'm sure everyone just looks at the group and says, oh, Stats must be seed one. No, it's actually Hurricane. And he's in very good shape. He started to play a lot better under pressure, which is really cool to see. I think that it's really reasonable to think he can get out of this group. Now, he's going up against Taeja. Taeja is one of these guys that is so unbelievably old school, such a talent from back in the day. He won countless tournaments. But mostly in the foreign scene, as you mentioned. This was before the foreigners really were anywhere near
this
the Koreans.
Yeah, let me just run off this idea for a second here, because this is really important to point out, is that the foreigners have really caught up to the Koreans. The Koreans are still more
they're
dominant.
Better except for, like, Serral and Raynor.
Yeah, they're still more dominant in higher numbers, but the foreigners are not that far behind. Then you have your Raynors and your Serrals that can compete with them. But Taeja was a killer in the era where... I think for foreign esports, StarCraft 2 is still very much in its infancy as far as skill goes. But obviously an incredible player nonetheless. Now the question is, how will he compete against a player like Hurricane, which I think is actually a very good match for two. I think it's going to be very interesting to see how this pans out. We're going to go to Nightshade for map number one. Hurricane versus Taeja. Game one starts now.
LG 울트라 기어와 넘버원 에너지 드링크 핫식스가 이번 전투를 지원한다고. 브레이브 스타 게이밍 허리케인 남기웅. 팀 리퀴드, 태자, 윤영석.
Yeah, so, you know, Taeja, definitely a very strong player again from back in the day. He had a few pretty good GSL finishes. I believe he got a round of 4 one time, if I'm recalling correctly.
This was pretty... But
it was a long time ago,
long
course.
Ago,
yeah. Yeah. But yeah, he was quite strong. Strong enough that when he tried to qualify for GSL, he was pretty much getting in, you know?
Yeah.
And once upon a time, we actually did have a deeper pool of players trying to qualify for GSL that could or could not make it in. Whereas right now, there's like 4 players that are on the fringe, and then everyone else makes it every time.
We're also in a weird, we're in a weird spot where for a lot of these guys, they have to make the choice. Do they serve their military service now, or do they push it further back?
Yeah.
And it's a really tough decision, you know? Because, of course, just to be clear, and I know I talk about this off and on, but... We actually get asked about this a decent amount. You cannot be a pro while you're doing your military service. You cannot actually earn money doing anything else when you're doing your military service. And so, of course, when you're done with that, yeah, you're welcome to come back. There's no age restriction on being a pro. But a lot of times, you know, the game is in a different place. And what you know then, especially in the way multiplayer games are now, where everybody's playing all the time, nonstop, you're oftentimes rendered obsolete. So... You can come back, but then you better catch up, and frankly, more than catch up, figure everything out, and then innovate on top of that.
Yeah.
And so that's what, that's the interesting story I'm looking for here.
Yeah.
How does Taeja look, and where does this game go?
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly what he's going to look like here. I'm not really holding my breath in such a tough group, because, like, really, all 3 of the other players are round of 16 caliber, it feels like, so... I think it's a very tough one for him. If he makes it through, I mean, that's awesome. That's amazing, because he is a player that just has so many fans from the old days.
Yeah.
Well, anyways, we'll see how he ends up doing. We have the Stargate coming up for Hurricane. Again, Hurricane's in quite good shape right now. I'm actually I feel like Taeja would have a better chance against Special and Stats than Hurricane, to be honest. Which sounds kind of weird,
Wait, did you just repeat that one more time?
I think
I want to make sure I heard you
correctly. Taeja will have a better shot. Like, I think Hurricane's the hardest match for him here.
Oh, really? And what makes you say that?
If you look at overall just how Hurricane plays, like, Stats playing a more defensive type of game is going to be a little bit more comfortable to play against, I think.
You think Stats, because he'll just leave... He'll leave him alone, and Taeja can then kind of focus on macro and pushing, where a lot of Protoss players kind of go for the heels, go for the ankles, go for the knees. A lot of their games.
Those sharp moves, I think, are a little bit more difficult. And then, you know, TVT is not TVP, so that's why he would do better against Special, I feel like.
Okay.
We'll see. I don't know. You know, Hurricane's still a guy that you're not sure what you're going to get in a game.
Yeah, well, I think he's one of these players. There's still a lot more... story to be written here in GSL for him.
Yeah, well, he's done a lot better lately, which is very cool to see. But it's just he chokes sometimes,
right,
under the pressure, and he did heavily for a very long time, but he's starting to come out of it, which is good, and I hope he can continue.
Oh my god, this is enough that, yeah, I don't even know if it would have been worth it to drop that at all. Probably better to just boost away, but that's actually an incredible blow here. The Phoenix is catching both the Widow Mines and killing them. The Medivac should be able to get back. Mm-hmm. The Marines can cover it, no problem. But, I mean, well, hold on a second. He pulled the Marines away for a little bit.
Yeah, this is like the greatest opening.
I am so surprised that he even picked that up. What? And somehow it lives, but.
Oh, wow.
So do all the Phoenixes, so. Funny game.
Looks like he really wanted to stop the harassment that was about to occur, and I guess he pretty much did, and damaged them quite a bit. So, all right, looks good. Some extra gates coming up. Did he go into Colossus tech?
I didn't see. We'll get a shot of the base in a little bit here. But he's gotten up to four Phoenixes now.
I don't know that he did. Like,
it wouldn't be crazy if he did do it.
Well, that
the units that Taeja's made here would be fine against infantry. We've seen it before, but I don't see the tech out here. I don't see any Robo tech out at all. We've mostly been following the Phoenixes and looking inside the Terran's base. So
yeah. Well, he has an Immortal now. I wonder if he is getting up into that splash damage. It feels like almost a needed thing as a follow-up to Phoenixes to get into some splash.
Sure.
Because your overall army is just going to be a bit weaker. Okay, there is that tech.
There we go. So we'll probably have a Colossus come out next here. And things are going to slow down for a little bit. We'll probably have the Phoenixes continue to roam here looking for any openings. But I think at this point in time, Terran's been pretty incentivized to not actually move out with any more medevacs or anything of the sort. Instead, power up, get your later third base, and probably push. In these positions, usually it's Terran first to attack.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you're on three bases going into Colossus tech. You've already done Phoenix tech. So
yeah.
You're kind of hoping to just weather the storm for a bit.
Yeah, absorb the blows and move on.
Well, Taeja does have his third command center, so he's playing a very standard, modern style right now, getting into the three racks, getting into the upgrades before taking that third. Has it ready, though. We'll see what he can get done. Has a little side drop, so this is going to be more multitasking.
Where are the Phoenixes now? Are they just back in the middle on the Protoss side?
Yeah, I'm not.
I can't find
them.
They're
above the natural.
Oh, you're right. Okay. So this drop may actually end up working out pretty nicely here. There's a lot to spot there, though, as well. And here comes the push. Now, a scan shows the one Colossus, plenty of Stalkers, Zealots, and Sentries as well.
Yeah, and he was just running, because that force can't actually do anything.
No, the Protoss army is literally better. Wow, and trapping the two Widow Mines. Great kills. That's four now we've had killed that have actually done no damage. But this drop is still inbound.
Yeah, didn't
now,
see it.
This drop is actually fairly dinky for what it's intended to do, especially because it's coming in late after the push is already chased away. So I don't think this should be able to do that much.
He didn't see it, though. He didn't see it at all. Taeja's got a group of Marines out in his base right now.
I guess you wouldn't necessarily be looking for this right now.
Oh, my God. Look at this.
It's kind of an oddly timed moment here. And so Taeja's going to come through and thrash these probes. Nine kills already. And now Taeja rotating down towards the 6 o'clock spot adjacent to the Protoss's third base.
Look at that, shutting down some of the upgrades as well for now. His other force just kind of roaming a bit, takes out a pylon that he saw at a different location. Looks like this medevac is going to go down, but I would say that was worth it. That was good, and during all that, he set up his third base. I like it. This was a cool play from Taeja. We don't see too many people play this opener like that.
Yeah, well, it started out a little bit rocky, but I'll tell you, if Hurricane had identified that, oh my God, okay, takes out the war president. If Hurricane had identified earlier that the medevac was actually hiding in plain sight in between the third and the main, maybe this would have been different. But yeah, a lot of damage was done there, and I think that really puts Taeja back into this game.
Yeah, you know, Hurricane did have pylons up, but that frontal group that he was chasing, I guess Hurricane was paying too much attention to it.
Yeah.
Just didn't see that medevac and took the damage because of it. But Hurricane is not by any means dead, right? He's still got a good probe count, even though he lost like 9 or 10. He's still teching very well. Look at this. He's got his +2 back online, getting Blink, has the second Forge, going in Disruptor tech, even getting a fourth base. So it's definitely a recoverable situation for him.
Oh my God. Great force fields here, locking out a lot of those Marauders. And that was not an even trade there for Terran at all. That was a lot blown up for... not too much damage. And we're seeing another great warp in round here. Now, Protoss is on four bases. Terran has been, I think Terran's been doing a good job, but overall, Protoss' defense, if you were to just subtract the one drop, Protoss' defense has been very good. They're basically...
Yeah, it has been.
Yeah, they're basically meeting the army wherever the army is, pushing it back, dealing more damage. Mm-hmm. But Taeja's far from done. He does have a lot more Vikings here now. And depending on the angles at which he hits, maybe he can start to take out the Colossus. It's really hard. It's one of the reasons why we see more Marauders in this army than there are even Marines, because the Marines just get vaporized once they get close enough to the Colossus with the splash damage. Okay, here we go. Coming in now.
You know what? There's disruptors in here, so I'm a bit nervous for Taeja.
Yes,
with
but where are the disruptors at?
They're with the army, actually.
Oh, I see it now. Sorry. Yeah, you're right. They're in the bottom left.
And that was actually a good engage by Taeja, though. He gets in, and then he moved out before he was actually going to get crushed there. Hurricane was actually lining himself up to clear that out.
And this was play that we actually, it kind of reminds me of the Taeja I used to see.
I'm getting chills right now.
Yeah.
He's playing a good game.
When we had almost too many tournaments for when StarCraft 2 first came out, but Taeja was just dominating. His movement is looking very clean.
Yes, it is. I'm liking what I'm seeing. And I was never like the biggest Taeja fan or anything, but I mean, this is some good, solid play that we've seen so far. Well, sits there, but you know what? That Blinken doesn't really do all that much. I like that he had the bunker behind the third. Unfortunately, no units in it, so he loses a buttload of SCVs, but the idea was there. Now that he's done a few good things, I just see good things everywhere, Tasteless.
You got your heart-shaped glasses on now for Taeja.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, some more Zealots are going to come through the top again. And, you know, this is one way to actually get back at the Terran is just to keep sending Zealots in there. This might be almost a comically large amount to send over
That's maybe two or three times to put it. He split it up. So.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, you left some.
If you send all of it, I'm like, well, you're still going to lose money sending these Zealots out.
Notice how most of those are not even attacking?
Yeah.
It would have been that, but more.
usually the number's like four or five or something like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, the Zealots continue to come through here. They're going to thrash these SCVs. Okay, an odd blink over there.
Yeah, a little bit. Oh, the disruptor shot doesn't get too much killed off there. He does have his liberators out, too.
Good stalker play here, sniping that one liberator. The command center is destroyed.
Ooh.
I think we all were expecting that to just be lifted. Oh, Gradient. Oh, my God.
Sick EMP, sick snipe.
Amazing. Things happened so fast, all he could do was make that sound with our mouth.
Yeah.
We could just make a noise out of our face holes. That was it.
That was it.
That's how you play-by-play
that.
That
was sick, though. Yeah. But he lost the command center during all this. He is doing a ton of damage over here. Oh, a big disruptor hit, though. It looks like there's going to be another one. Yeah, those disruptor hits. Looking strong, but he's sitting here fighting partially under a liberator.
I think Protoss is actually still okay. I think Protoss fends this off. Yeah, that's it. GG. Hurricane wins.
You know,
and what was a pretty explosive endgame there. There was a lot. That was pretty epic. I love the EMP onto all the Templars. All the Templars are picked up, and immediately the Warp Prism is destroyed.
Yeah. It's like, no.
That was Ninja Scroll level violence.
Oh, my God.
Man.
That was a good first game.
That was a nice
showing
I'm
by
fired
Taeja,
up.
I think.
I'm fired up over that
game.
That was great.
Yeah, me too. That's really exciting to see. And, like, a couple small things went wrong there. The Zealot harassed me. He had a bunker at his third, but nothing there, so he lost a bunch of SCVs. And then the second group goes in. He didn't send enough to clear it. It didn't really go all that well. He lost the command center. And then he was kind of all in with that army. It was the right move, I think, what he did because of the damage he took.
Yeah.
But obviously we saw, you know, that was, I don't think he wanted to go all in at that point. It's just, it kind of was like, well, we may as well.
Okay, Eternal Empire from map number two. I really like the way that game looked because they were both strong. Taeja was definitely the player from a different era, but he was holding his own. I think he makes a few more adjustments in his play, and maybe he actually comes out here and beats Hurricane. But Hurricane was able to hold off each attack and eventually snowball that game to a victory. Game two starts now.
Brave Star Game, Hurricane, Namgyung. Team Liquid, Taeja, Yun Young-sun.
Well, definitely a cool game there.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that Taeja can show us similar moves here, where he's taking something that's somewhat basic and then kind of putting his own little flair on it and making some smart decisions as where to move his army. That was really great. Like, the medevac getting through into the main. I liked his liberator range coming up in a very timely fashion.
Yeah.
That's something that I've been pretty shocked that we've seen, like, none of so far this season. I think it's fantastic that they moved that upgrade, Liberator Range, to the Fusion Core. You know, You can just continually react our units out. You don't have to switch to a tech lab. It makes it so much more streamlined. You get more units that way.
Right.
It's just, it seems like
it's made the whole process a lot less clunky.
Yeah. And it felt very smooth the way Taeja was going about it.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, too. Taeja looked like a very modern player in that game.
Yeah, he did.
He was playing just like every other Terran is, which is great. Occasionally we'll have a player come back and, like, they're doing something weird and from the past, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, sort of, it's not, like, it doesn't work, but it's not what everybody's doing.
It was kind of cool the other night to see Bomber with his parade push.
Mm-hmm.
That was a neat.
Yeah. I was like, oh, look at this. It still kind of looks like him in the game.
Well, I like them bringing back these pieces of themselves. Like, yeah, you have to modernize, but if you're not playing your own style, I think you said it well, where you're like, well, you have to catch up to the meta, but then also kind of do your own thing, innovate something.
Yeah, you better be adding more than just...
Yeah, you can't... If you, like, just copy Maru, people say play like Maru, but really, if you just try to copy Maru, you're never going to be a champion because...
Yeah, you'll be high on the ladder.
Yeah, it's like you'll be a good player, but you'll never actually do anything. You need to have your own stuff. You know, and so it's cool to see these older players kind of come back with some modernized play, but with some of their older ideas still.
So generally speaking, at least especially for this season, we're seeing the Protosses get the third base before the Terran, and Terran kind of take their third as they're pushing and try to get the Protoss out of position. We've seen Colossus Tech become popular as a way to basically hold a lot of infantry coming in early on. You know,
we don't see too many Templar openings, do we?
Not really. I thought we might have a little bit more, but it's pretty clear that at this level, this is really the way that people are approaching
people are
it.
Are really mostly out here right now.
Yeah,
for the
most
part.
It kind of makes sense. I'm interested to see that it hasn't been punished more with medevacs like Widow Mines, or at least in the tournament that we've had so far here. But I guess we've also seen, for instance, in the last game, Phoenixes were made as a way to basically answer that, and that really puts some pressure on the Terran, where if you are going to drop them, then you might risk losing the medevac and the two Widow Mines or anything else, and then it's like, you know, from the Protoss' perspective, it's just you're getting further ahead. All you have to do is swat away their little attack, and you're getting that much bigger, and you're that much more likely to survive the push later on. Yeah. And this is a matchup, you know. If you guys have watched previous GSLs, a lot of times I would say there's more ambiguity with, you know, who gets to take a base win, especially when you're further apart, like on some of these huge maps we've had where it's like you can't quite attack into each other. But it does seem like now Protosses in this current meta, on these current maps, seem to just get their third every time. And Terran is going to try to come in here with some type of drop. Yeah. It looks like we're going to have that just line up right here.
Well, I think that's kind of the way to do it, right? They are really ready, but he gets it out. But either you're going to do some sort of two-base, very hyper-aggressive all-in play as Protoss, or you're going to go three-base, get your upgrade slash splash going, and try to hold, right?
Right.
Because that's when you start to get very powerful as Protoss. Protoss definitely, you know, we were talking about how Protoss has a very hard time late game against Zerg. It's very playable against Terran in the late game.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. I find this matchup a lot of fun in general to cast.
Yeah, I like it a lot, especially in later portions of the game.
Yeah.
Like, the two-base attack that comes out from Terran, I feel like sometimes that's a bit too decisive. Those games I don't like as much when it's like,
Where they're going to try to end it with that?
Yeah, that's... Yeah. I've never been a fan
of
two-base
all-ins. Sometimes SCVs are pulled and it's like... Okay.
Well, when the SCVs get pulled, I'm just like, no.
Yeah.
I'm like, I don't have anything to do with this.
This can't be the way. There's got to be a better way to do this.
Yeah. Okay, so Taeja just kind of playing that same style here, getting quite a bit of units out.
It should be pointed out again, this is the style that Terrans are using right now, not Taeja's style so much. Taeja's unit movement, though, is looking similar to like what we've seen in the past, where he was just very good at controlling the map, very good at playing the zoning game. On both sides, you're trying to, especially in this matchup where it's like there's a lot of abilities that have to be casted at once. When the fight starts, Protoss have like so many things they need to shoot out, and so do Terran. They got to stim, and they got to figure out, are they going to push in or pick up with their medevacs and go back out? And so with each engagement, it's really important to watch and see how the players handle it, because this game is a fast game. You can, and this is a moment where we see Taeja not quite pulling away in time, losing one medevac there, or Widowmine there. Sorry.
Well, Taeja pushing out. He is making that third command center on location, getting his additional barracks pretty quickly here as well. Nice little small zealot harassment here, just slowing that down. That's very, very annoying for Terran.
Well, especially because Terran does need to catch up and get that third CC up. And oh no, easy free kill there on the medevac. I don't even know why it got moved over there. Yeah. We saw it was actually over the...
He might have made a hallucination. If it wasn't on hold position,
oh, and he just nudges it over there to the side. That's smart.
I don't know if that's the case, but I see something floating there right now. So that's my guess.
I think that's an observer.
Or there could have been an F2 moment as well. You know,
good point. Yeah,
where you're being lazy. Get punished for that. Anyways, Taeja right now, he's macroing pretty well. This is a very gateway heavy style that we're seeing out of Hurricane. He's got the plus one, he's got the charge, he's got the blink, and he's got a lot of units.
Okay, an attack in here. A lot of Widowmines going off, making there no more Zealots now in this fight. Stalkers and Sentries still over here, but Terran is not quite getting the angle that Terran needs to really do the damage they want to do. We see there's other units elsewhere on the map, but for now, Hurricane's going to advance a little bit further forward here.
Yeah, still looks like he wants to push a little bit more.
Yeah, especially with the War Prism there.
Yeah, yeah.
And a fourth is taken. I don't know if Hurricane's going to commit. I think he might be able to,
though. If you're taking a fourth here, you're not committing. But I love this move, right? Drop the natural, see how many units come back, and maybe you can hit the third if he sends his units.
He's going to send this back up here. He actually wants to. Now, this might be Hurricane. He's trying to get too much over here, but taking out those Widow Mines is pretty huge.
And look at this. If he brings the Prism over now and warps in at the third.
Oh, my God.
That's a strong move right there.
Yeah, I don't know. Is this going to work, though? This is, like, so much.
Yeah, I don't think he's... He doesn't necessarily kill him here.
Oh,
the Force Fields, in fact, are blocking the Zealots, but the amount of SCVs he's gotten...
Yeah, actually, it looks like if he backs up and maybe does another warp in here... Yeah, that was a great
save.
That
was a really good save on those Sentries. I was like, oh, no, he's going to lose four Sentries. Nope.
You really called this, Artosis, by saying that Hurricane, is going to be a much tougher fight here for Taeja. This is already looking like a very difficult game.
Well, he's as modern as you can really get.
Yeah.
He's just on top of stuff right now.
He's the newest smartphone. Like all the other players, there's different types of smartphones.
Yeah.
They can do everything. They can email. They can text, but his are, a little bit better.
Taeja's BlackBerry.
Is Taeja BlackBerry right now?
Yeah. He's discontinued, but
Taeja's
you know
a Palm
what?
Pilot. It's even worse.
Still got one. I'm a pager.
Yeah.
Taeja's is a rotary telephone.
Yeah, I'm an answering machine is all I am.
Yeah. Now, I'm fire on top of a mountain.
Now, Taeja is probably going to try to push back across the map here. But Hurricane really got to get ahead in multiple different ways. I think that when he was retreating, he lost a decent amount, and that's got to hurt. But how exactly is this next attack going to be handled here? Terran has a lot of Marauders,
which
is pretty scary.
What's the Immortal count at? Is he at three right now?
Something like that, yeah. It's at one.
No, that's units lost.
Oh, sorry. it's right there.
He only has one.
Yeah. Look at the top. He only has one immortal in his whole army.
Yeah, he has three here. So the Marauder Heavy is not as scary. And he's sitting in a kind of... he shouldn't be coming down the ramp. If he just kind of, goes back and forth and zones out this army from attacking, he's in good shape, especially with something like that warping in.
If he's got Storm, this is going to be very hard to ever advance up. Good splitting. Keep in mind that the War Prism is not being used to try to juggle. Oh, I wish he would not.
Do you see this? Zealot keeps on jiggling and getting out of range. Oh my god. It's like that gif of the guy with the Xbox controller.
Oh yeah, where he makes a circle and then the storm comes down and kills all the bands.
That was insane.
Yeah.
Whoa. So Taeja maybe skimping a little bit. We don't see any like anti-prism technology, such as the missile turret or a Viking. So the prism so far has just done a lot of work against it.
So we have more warping in. Did Protoss actually just push this? It seems like it, especially when the four immortals come down there, the natural enemy to the Marauder. I think we're pretty close to the end of this story here.
Yeah, yeah, it's not feeling too hot for Taeja right now.
Yeah, he's microing, but that number is getting very, very small. And I gotta say, Hurricane will be playing a masterful technical Protoss versus Terran against an old school giant. In Taeja, GG, Hurricane takes series, number one, and will be waiting to play his match in the winner's match. Taeja is not out yet. He has a chance to prove himself again. And I'll tell you what, he did look good. I don't know if he looks good enough to get to the round of 16, though.
Yeah, yeah, I would generally agree with that.
Like, no disrespect.
But he did look good. I feel like there's a few things he needs to do.
Right.
He needs to have something to deal with the prism, whether you're like flying a Viking around in your base. Maybe if you made an early Liberator, you can keep that in there looking for it. Throw a missile turret down. I tell you, a couple missile turrets is a lot cheaper than what a prism's going to do to you.
Right, yeah.
So we saw him a little bit struggling with that in this previous game.
Also, Hurricane didn't overdo it with the Zealot Harass. He dropped, for instance, one Zealot, the natural.
Yeah,
then
good.
He looped through the main, which pulled most of the army back in there, and then he just sent the War Prism back out to the third. It was a really good tactic.
Yeah, it was.
Which allowed so much punishment to happen at that third base.
It was played so well from him because he like did it and got away with just enough after doing just enough that there was no way to really die to anything Taeja could do from there.
Yeah, yeah.
And he did a good amount of damage economically to him. He killed like 15 SCVs during that attack.
Again, though, Taeja looking strong, good at fights, but not good at, I guess, not ticking all the boxes of controlling a StarCraft II game.
Yeah.
You know, even in game one, we saw the Zealot counterattack get in there, kill a lot of SCVs. Taeja's looking strong. Also, Taeja not always keeping track of his medevacs. In both games, game one, he just straight up got shot down by the Phoenixes. Those two Widowmines were picked up.
Yeah, that happens.
And then in game two, he had a medevac waiting in a big chasm where no ground units can go.
I think it was
presumably
an F2 error, maybe.
That, or you said maybe a hallucination pushes it or something
possibly,
like that. But look, either way, I mean, if you set that up, you need to keep it there for as long as possible so you can punish later. And then he lost that just
maybe,
to some
maybe
stalkers.
Maybe we can patch it. Maybe we can make it like the Observer and the Overseer where you can just give it more range by not letting it move. You do that siege mode thing so that F2, you can just... Can we just fix anything so that F2 doesn't grab it? We can do it with High Templars, too.
Yeah, there we go.
Where they go into siege mode and they just don't move. Those are my favorite patches.
we're going to go to a short break. When we come back, our second best of three. Don't go away.